It's absolutely incredible.
Hey, Tony.
When you have finished recording, you may hang up or press.
Yeah, all right. We're having problems getting Tony online tonight. Hopefully, we'll have him back another time. So, but meanwhile, keep going. I'm a firm believer that when you talk about the fact that the 1994 Montreal Expos, to me, were a team that had a chance to go ahead and
finally do it, right?
Yeah, I think they had the best record in baseball is what at the time of the strike.
And managed by such a great, you know, a guy who came from a family of baseball greats, and Felipe Alou managed his son, a young Moises Alou, I believe, right, was the left fielder on that team at the time. And what's funny is it's unfortunate in the case of the Expos, but a myriad of those players wound up going on to play on and win World Series. If we fast forward 2 years, John Wetland, who was the closer on that 94 team, is the closer for the Yankees when they beat the Atlanta Braves in one of the better World Series in recent memory. You know, I was born actually the day of game five when Bobby Cox got ejected, and before Dave Martinez injection, I believe in game six, no manager had been ejected since the day that Bobby Cox was ejected in that World Series game for the Braves. But no, I mean, it's unfortunate the fact that 94 Expos team, we saw Wetland would win with the Yankees in 96. Martinez finally, you know, who's your daddy in 03, Grady Little. We could talk about that all day. You know, he's left in too long. He wins in 2004. I mean, Moises Alou, he never got there again. He was actually on the wrong side of it again, because if we remember that Steve Bartman play in 2003, the Alex Gonzalez era at shortstop, you know, Alou's the left fielder that misses that ball, and he's, you know, very, and you can remember Tom Brenneman, Marty Brenneman's son, you know, screaming out, he you know, his foul ball to Alou, and he is livid with a fan. You know, I'll never forget the way he said that, the way that that was delivered. And it's something that was played in, you know, all across the city of Chicago for the next 13 years, and maybe all across the country until they won again. But, you know, the fact that they were able to do this, and I think if there's one player on that team I'm most happy for, not only is it Strasburg, because it totally gets rid of the narrative that surrounded him in 2012 when he came back and he was electric in his first year full season post-Tommy John, it's Max Scherzer. And I say it for this reason. We saw what happened before the start of Game 5 when Scherzer had neck spasms, and something that had caused him some pain previously in the season. I believe in July he was placed on the injured list with back spasms and neck spasms, and it caused him to miss nearly a month's worth of starts, you know, 5-6 starts. And, you know, for somebody like Scherzer, who, you know, who he wasn't always this great pitcher that we knew, and a story that most people don't know is a story about his brother, and his brother's name is former brother Alex Scherzer. Alex Scherzer actually unfortunately passed away via suicide in 2012. Right. Max Scherzer's brother had long suffered from depression and unfortunately took his own life. Max Scherzer dedicated every start he ever made to him. And again, I've talked about Greinke before and the struggles that he's went through, and the fact that he got to pitch the way he did in Game 7, though he was on the losing end of it, is rough, but it's great for him, given all of what Greinke has, you know, the adversities he's battled. But for Scherzer, who's dedicated every start to his brother, I think the fact that he finally got to win that World Series and, you know, dedicate that game, which I'm sure he did, to his brother that night, last night, I thought that was amazing. You know, he wasn't Max Scherzer that we are used to seeing, who was striking out 17 in the no-hitter against the Mets in 2015, or throwing, you know, he's thrown two no-hitters, he's won three Cy Young Awards. It's perfect. You know, like, I love Clayton Kershaw. He's my favorite player. He's the best pitcher of this generation. But Max Scherzer has more rings than Clayton Kershaw does, and I hate to admit that, but he does. And, you know, I'm just so proud for a guy like Scherzer. And the image I think that will forever be ingrained in my mind, I don't know if you saw it last night, it's him and Anibal Sanchez, teammates on the 2013 Tigers, that, or 2012 Tigers, I apologize, but also that year as well, who lost to the San Francisco Giants.
Right. No, I know. They had a couple interesting runs there for a while.
But the one image that I'll never forget is Anibal Sanchez running out of the dugout. He's got his jacket on, and Scherzer's in tears, but I don't think there's anybody that loves baseball more than Max Scherzer today, and they're both embracing each other, and he goes, "We did it, we're number one, we're world champs," and again, paraphrasing, but it was a beautiful sight to see. And it's really, despite the fact that these guys make millions of dollars doing what they do, to revert yourself to that of a child as far as the euphoria goes that they both exuded last night, I thought that was amazing. And it, for me, it just reaffirms how beautiful, because, like, I'll give you an example. I think what makes winning a World Series in baseball a lot more unique than winning, say, the Super Bowl.
Right.
How many times have we seen a football game, and even in a couple of Super Bowls, where they just run the last minute of the clock out, right? A couple of QB kneels, and then, you know, they just start celebrating on the field. It's a beautiful sight, right? I mean, like, you've pretty much done what you set out to do at the outset of the offseason, right. And then throughout the season, every, you know, pretty much every brick has fallen into place. But to see it embraced like that, I don't think you get that in other sports. Maybe you get it with Jordan when he wins that title and he, you know, he's taken off the net after he comes back from retirement. I believe that was his fourth ring. But it's beautiful. I'll quote the movie Clockwork Orange: it's gorgeousness and gorgeousity all right. In one. It's amazing.
Well, let's talk about a couple of other things. I know Bryce Harper obviously might be rethinking his decision here for not staying with the Nationals without a doubt. I mean, think about it. You talk about a guy eating humble pie. He's definitely it. You know, I mean, you know, and then, of course, now the question is, can the Nationals go ahead and retain their free agents? And the fact, and not only that, when you look at Steven Strasburg, he was shut down back in 2012, and now it paid dividends long term. Who'd have thought any of those scenarios would take place?
I mean, yeah, look, Harper, I genuinely think, though, if Harper's on that team, I don't think they win the World Series. I would genuinely make the argument, and I love Bryce Harper. I think he's a great player, and I agree with you in regards to his ego. I think that he was a big distraction in that clubhouse because of all of the speculation that surrounded him. Even with the contract, I still think he would have been a distraction, because if Bryce Harper goes out and hits 260, and let's not mention the fact that he played in the same division, the NL East, with the Philadelphia Phillies, and he goes out and he has a season he has, very respectable, 4.2 wins above replacement. I won't get too stat heavy.
Right.
But the fact that he was able to do what he did, you know, in the first year of the contract, it's still a good season, but I don't think Nationals fans would have been happy with it, especially after the fact that he didn't have a particularly great season in 2018, a .241 right. average, you know, or .249. He just makes the All-Star team because it's in D.C. He wins the home run derby. Great. That's the send-off for him. That's how he's going to be remembered. I think he would have been too much of a distraction, and I say that with the utmost respect because I genuinely love Bryce Harper, and he's a player I love to see do well, because I love his game plan. I love the fact that he's very selective. He takes his walks, but he has a very aggressive swing that leads to a lot of undercuts. He swings under the baseball a lot, and the reason he probably hit for such a low average and struck at a career 169 times is that he was always under the baseball. I mean, when he connects, Bryce Harper hitting a home run is one of the most beautiful sights in all of baseball. Right. I think when he connects on a baseball, it's poetry in motion. I mean, like, it's like hearing I don't know. It's like hearing the sound of Dean Martin sing, or it's like hearing Frank Sinatra croon. It's beautiful. But I think he would have been too much of a distraction on the team. And you know what? You're right. He did get a slice of humble pie. But to his credit, he did want to bring a title back to D.C., and he did it.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about an interesting scenario that obviously I don't think will happen, but it's been talked about. What are your thoughts about the Tampa Bay Rays possibly playing half their games in Montreal, even though I don't think it's a logistical possibility with the travel and all the complications that involve, especially when you deal with the legal system?
I think Manfred just needs to work on expanding and getting another two teams in the league so it can be 32 like the NFL. To have a team play 40 games in one city and 41 in another is absurd.
Right.
Because obviously, one team is going to get an extra game. They're going to get an extra game's worth of revenue. I don't really like it. And you can make the argument that it'll create more jobs in the Montreal metropolitan area. But still, at what expense? You're going to tire a team out. And say if the Rays have another 90-win season, you know, in a couple of years, if they were to ever enact that policy, and I think it would be asinine because you're going to be playing more road games than your home games. Hypothetically, it's like, the team's not even going to recognize what their home games are. And realistically, right. Stuart Sternberg just needs to petition for a stadium because Tampa...
He's tried. The bottom line is, no matter what they've tried to do, whether it's Hillsborough or Pinellas County, he's getting nowhere. And in fact, that dysfunction in that area goes so far back that many, many years ago, they tried to get a stadium actually on the site of where Raymond James Stadium actually was, where they had the Bucks and the baseball team.
Yeah.
But St. Petersburg built that stadium down wherever it wasn't supposed to build it anyways. As a result, they said, you want the team bad enough? You did it. And then also, and then you have a lease that ties it to 2027 back then.
Yeah, it's insane. And it's unfortunate that they're playing so well in these you know, very bad circumstances. It's funny. They remind me a lot of the 2016 Cleveland Indians, because even when they were winning all of those games, if whenever I would watch MLB Network at night, they would never have enough fans in the stands. Like, do you understand? You guys were seeing the, you know, the continued, you know, ascendancy to acehood of Corey Kluber. Right. Francisco Lindor establishing himself with those beautiful pearly white teeth as one of the most charismatic young stars in the game. And they didn't have enough fans out at those games. They did in the World Series because half of them came from Chicago on the north side.
Right.
But, you know, it's just like you guys need to pay attention. When you have a good baseball team, and the Tampa Bay Rays, they won like 97 games this year. The fact that they couldn't sellout crowds until the postseason.
Right.
I don't know about you, but I find that a little insulting.
Yeah, but that sellout crowd you're talking about was a 32,000 draw. It wasn't like they filled the stadium. All they did was remove tarps.
But it's ridiculous, though. I think people need to appreciate. It's the same thing that can be said if we talk about why people don't like LeBron James. Just appreciate greatness. I'm not saying the Rays are a perfect franchise because, look, they have one pennant and they didn't win the World Series, though. I did lose $20 in sixth grade on betting that the Rays would win it just because I was riding the Joe Madden mojo. But at the same time, you just need the city of St. Petersburg or Tampa needs to work on getting them a stadium. The Tropicana. You're not going to do it the way that the Marlins did when Jeffrey Loria essentially booted the city into doing it, because the Marlins
That's a fleas job.
Yeah.
You're really talking about, have you spent much time in the Tampa area at all to understand the
logistics? Saw a game at Steinbrenner Field, and that was
all right. That to me is where the stadium should be, as it's Steinbrenner Field.
And I agree, too, because it's in such a nicer location. It's really not a lot of bad traffic getting out of there. But, yeah, I mean, look, if the Rays continue to play well, I think the legitimacy of this claim for the stadium, the same way that the A's have it with the O.co, which I believe they have one more year on their lease, if I'm not mistaken. With Oakland. They need to work on both of those teams.
That situation is closer to getting resolved than
absolutely,
the other one. Yeah, I think that there's talk about the Franklin Terminal out there where they're trying to get the land. So I think the A situation stands a chance to get resolved a lot more than otherwise, but the race situation is hopeless.
It is ridiculous. And, like, look, the American League East is one of the best divisions in baseball. I know that the Blue Jays are rebuilding, but you have nice young players in Bo Bichette and Vlad Guerrero Jr. You know, you can talk about them getting a new stadium in a couple of years. I'm not a big fan. The Blue Jays.
We're talking about.
No, I'm saying we could start talking about it soon, because I'm not crazy about the Rogers Center. I'm not a big fan of AstroTurf.
Never been there?
No, I've never been to Canada. Well then, so.
All right, well, there you go. Okay, I have. And you know what? I don't see them build another stadium in Canada.
Probably
they'll make
not.
The best of that.
But, you know,
I've been there before.
I mean, what are you going to do, though? You're going to get a team and call what the Expos did their last 2 years and play games in Huron Beathorn Stadium in Puerto Rico?
Yeah, right.
We're not doing that.
I don't know. Yeah, well, that's why they ended up with the Nationals. So.
Yeah, I mean, but still, it's like at least the Miami Dolphins, a team that we can, you know, constantly give credit for being one of the more inept organizations in the NFL, and this season is no exception to that notion. But at least they redid their stadium. You know, Stephen Ross put in the money he needed to.
Well, he'll spend the money. There's no doubt about that.
I mean, he did on Ndamukong Suh when we won 6 games that year.
Right, wow.
But, you know, at the same time, like, the Rays deserve their own stadium. Every baseball team deserves their own stadium.
Right.
And if, you know, Manfred can come out and talk about the suggestions that they're making regarding the minor leagues and eschewing out 40 other teams and putting them in what he's referring to as a dream league and upgrade facilities, which is way overdue. These guys don't get paid enough. I mean, they're barely surviving as is in the minor leagues. A major league team, one of your 30 teams, guys. Manfred, I hope you're listening. You can work on improving that stadium or get them a new one. I mean, they need to talk with the city of Tampa. They need to talk with, you know, they need to talk with people in St. Petersburg. They need fan output. They just need to get something going to where they can play in a respected stadium. Look at Turner Field is a perfect example of that. It wasn't a great stadium. It was built for the purpose of the Olympics in 96, right? You have the iconic moment of Ali with the torch. I mean, the Braves already won the World Series in 95 in Fulton County Stadium when, you know, Grissom catches that fly ball with Wohlers on the mound. But come on. Turner Field was never really served the purpose as a perfect baseball stadium, and it's a little bit
better. Well, that's why they built a brand new one.
Exactly, but look at that, though, and look how quickly that was built.
Yeah, but the one thing I'll say about the Atlanta situation, though, is at least they took that Turner Field and they turned it into a football stadium for Georgia State football, just as what happened with the Rangers place out in Arlington, mm-hmm. that they took that same field and turned it into a XFL field for who knows how long that league will be in existence anyway. So go figure.
Yeah, the fragility of those leagues that aren't the NFL is always, you know, what are you going to bring back, lingerie football next? Like, how long did that last for?
I'm not talking about that, but I can appreciate that. So, you know, let's go over a couple.